and we need one of each of these to make it balance. So the formula reflects this: one lead, one sulfur, and that's the formula of lead sulfide. So again, pause the snapcast and have a go at this one. So we have magnesium as the metal in group 2. The non-metal is chloride coming from chlorine, which is in group 7. So hopefully you've established that the chloride ion is Cl minus, and being a group 2, that the magnesium ion is Mg2 plus. So we have Mg2 plus and we have Cl minus. We have a 2 plus ion and we have a single minus ion. How do we balance this? And it's balanced using another minus. So we need this times 2 and we need this times 1. Again, in a moment's carelessness, we end up with people who write Mg2Cl. So be careful. We're taking one of the magnesiums, we're taking two of the chlorides. And that is the formula of magnesium chloride. Okay, let's try another one. So we've got sodium as the metal part, carbonate as the non-metal part. And what does 8 alert us to? So sodium is down here. Carbonate would be on the data sheet. What is the formula of carbonate? And separately, what is the charge of carbonate? What's the formula of sodium? And its charge. So we have a simple ion sodium in group 1. It's a metal, so it has a positive charge. It's in group 1, it has a 1 positive. Carbonate is a compound ion. It's made up of carbon and oxygen. What's its formula? CO3. Separately, what's its charge? 2 minus. So we have a single positive ion, and we have a double minus ion. How can we balance this? What do we need to do? We need another positive ion. So we need this times 2 and this times 1. Again, stick with it and make sure that you put the 2 in the correct place. We need 2 sodiums. So it's Na2CO3. Now, at this stage, I think you've got used to the idea of balancing formulae, although at this stage we still haven't made use of brackets. But I want to start factoring in now, in each of these questions, how we work out relative molecular mass. When we look at the mass of a compound, its mass is the sum of its parts. Do you know how to work out the mass of a sodium atom? Well, if you look at the periodic table, along with sodium, you'll find two numbers, 11 and 23. In most periodic tables, the smaller number is at the top, but be aware that you need to look at both numbers and select the smaller number for the if you want the atomic number, which is the number of protons. It's defined as giving the number of protons in an atom of the element. So sodium atoms all have 11 protons, though that number also indicates the number of electrons, since atoms have equal numbers of protons and electrons. It's this number down here that we're interested in. This here is known as the relative atomic mass, or RAM for short. It's the average mass of an atom of the element compared to 1/12 the mass of a C12 carbon atom. So, and remember, these are relative masses. So they compare the mass of one atom with another. So if one has a mass of 12, like for example carbon has an atomic mass of 12, a relative atomic mass of 12, and magnesium, a relative atomic mass twice that of 24, they are relative, so it means that a magnesium atom is twice as heavy as a carbon atom. Now, the atomic mass of sodium is 23. And in this formula, you can see that we had two of these. We had two sodium ions. Now, a sodium ion has the same mass as a sodium atom, because although it's lost an electron, you should recall from atomic structure that electrons are considered to have negligible mass, so it doesn't affect the mass of the sodium when it goes from an atom to an ion. And there are two of these, so we'll have to multiply that figure by two. So the mass that sodium contributes to this compound, sodium carbonate, is twice 23, or 46. There's just one carbon in this formula. You're expected to be able to reason that in this formula, CO3, we have one carbon, and the three in the CO3, we're supposed to be able to reason that there are three O's in it. Now there's only one carbon, and if you look up carbon in the periodic table, see, you'll find two numbers, a 6 and a 12. And it's the bigger number that is the relative atomic mass. So in terms of this compound sodium carbonate, the carbon contributes a mass of 12. And the oxygens, if you look up oxygen in the periodic table, you'll find that there are two numbers, an 8 and a 16. And again, it's the bigger number we're looking for. The atomic mass of oxygen is 16. And these three oxygens here will contribute a mass which is 3 times 16. In other words, 48. So I'm beginning to look here at what's called relative molecular mass, which is the overall mass of the compound. And that's worked out as the sum of its parts. And the way we should do this, generally put a sort of a margin down the side of your page and show anyone marking your work how you've reasoned the relative molecular mass. In this case, we're looking at the relative molecular mass of sodium carbonate, and I would suggest you do it like this. Show that you've worked out two sodiums. Two 23s, remember, the atomic mass of sodium over here was 23. Two 23s, 46. There is one carbon, which is 12, and there are three oxygens, which gives us total 3 16s, 48. And we add these up, and that comes out as 106. And that is known as the relative molecular mass of sodium carbonate, or capital M with a subscript with a small r like this, is a symbol for relative molecular mass. The relative molecular mass of sodium carbonate is 106. I suggest you pause here for a minute and reflect upon what we've done before you try some of the questions that follow, where I want you now to do two things. I want you to work out in each of the following examples, A, the balanced formula, and B, I want you to work out the relative molecular mass based on the fact that the relative molecular mass of a compound is the sum of its parts. Okay. Rubidium. Now, where would we find rubidium? I don't have it in my little periodic table. It only goes down to, as you can see here, it goes down as far as potassium in group 1. Below potassium you have rubidium, and then below that again in group 1 you have cesium. But all we need to know is what group it is in. So rubidium is in group 1. What does that mean about its charge? Yeah, it'll be a plus charge. And the other ion was chloride, rubidium chloride. Where is chlorine found? Yeah, it's found over here. So hopefully you've reasoned that we have RB has a positive charge, chloride has a minus charge. So we have a positive ion and we have a negative ion. Does that balance? Of course it does. So the formula of rubidium chloride is RbCl. Now, I'd like you to work out the relative molecular mass of rubidium chloride, please. You do not have the relative molecular mass of rubidium, so would you take 85 for that? Its relative atomic mass is 85. So in this case we've got one rubidium, its atomic mass is 85, that contributes 85 to the overall mass. We have one chlorine, chlorine is 35.5, it contributes that to the overall mass. So 120.5. Have a go at this one. And again, ammonium. Hopefully you'll be aware that the ammonium ion is a compound ion. This is the only compound, only positive compound ion that we come across in GCSE, the ammonium ion. There are quite a number of negative compound ions, but this is the only positive compound ion, the ammonium ion. So again, I hope that you would realize that you're not going to get that from the periodic table. You're going to get it from the data sheet on the back of the periodic table. So here's the ammonium ion. What is its formula? Its formula is NH4, which means it has this N, H, 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 H. That's what NH4 means. That's the significance of the 4 here. Now separately, you should think separately, what is the charge on this ion? Shown in book, the charge is a single positive charge. Don't mix up the 4 with the charge. 4 reflects the fact that it has 4 hydrogens. Its charge, separate issue, is it has a single positive charge. So we have the ammonium along with the hydroxide. Now again, hopefully you appreciate that hydroxide is not an element. Hydroxide is, you'll have to recall, is another one of these compound ions. This is it here. You would find it on the back of the periodic table. I remind you again that you would, your periodic table in the exam would not look like this. The compound ions that I've shown in red here would be on the... So what's the formula of the hydroxide ion? The answer is it is OH. And then a separate question, what's the charge of the compound ion? And it's shown in black here, minus. So this ion is NH4+, and this ion is OH with a minus charge. So we have positive ion. Yes, of course it does. And this is reflected formula. We have one of these NH4 and one of these OH minus ions, and that's the formula. Again, I'd like you to work out the relative molecular mass, written like this, or alternatively like this, for ammonium hydroxide. You must be aware that that means we have a nitrogen, we have 4 hydrogens. This reflects the number of the element next to it, to the left of it. Plus we have an oxygen and a hydrogen. In fact, we've got 5 hydrogens, 1 nitrogen and 1 oxygen. So we have 1 nitrogen. Up the periodic table for nitrogen, you'll find that with it you have the number 7 and 14. And this is the number we want, its relative atomic mass. So it's 1 times 14 is 14. We have 5 hydrogens in total. We have 4 of them here, but we have another one here, a fifth one here. So we have 5 hydrogens. Atomic mass of hydrogen is 1, relative atomic mass. And we have 1 oxygen here. The atomic mass of oxygen is 6. So we have a total mass of 31. Pause the snapcast and have a go again. This should say nitrate and copper to nitrate. Copper is not in groups 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's in the middle here. It's a transition element. And because of that, you need to be told its charge. There are, in fact, 2 different coppers. There's a copper plus ion with a single plus charge, quite rare. And there's a Cu2 plus. And you need to be told in the examination which one you're dealing with. So it'll say either copper 1, like this, Roman numerals. But more commonly, much more commonly, you'd be dealing with copper 2 written like this. And in this example, we're dealing with copper 2. And we're looking at nitrate as well. Nitrate, remember that with nitrate, this should ring bells in your head when you hear eight or ite, an indication of the presence of oxygen. So this is not an element. You should be looking then at the reverse side of the periodic table to see which one it is. So we're dealing here with nitrate, here it is. What's the formula of a nitrate ion? Formula is NO3, which means you've got one nitrogen and one, two, three oxygens. And separately, what's the charge shown in black here of the nitrate ion? Yeah, it has a single minus charge. So copper is a metal, it's definitely positive. And because it's copper 2, it's 2 positive. So we have Cu2 plus. Nitrate, you can hear it in the name, nitrate. The nit indicates nitrogen, the 8 indicates oxygen. So I would be looking certainly for N and O. And we will look at the data sheet and we saw that its formula is NO3 and its charge is minus. So we have a 2 plus ion and we have a minus ion. So what do we need to do? We'll have to take another one of these minus ions to make it balance. So we're taking this times 1 and we're taking this times 2. Again, stick with it so that you put the numbers in the correct place. 1 copper, and we're going to need 2 of these nitrate ions. Now this is the first time we've come across this particular issue here. Now can I scroll back for a moment to my initial rules on this page? And this particular rule here, multiplying compound ions needs brackets. And conversely, simple ions don't ever use brackets. Now let me show you what I mean by that rule. We'll go back to our slide. This is a compound ion, the nitrate ion, and we need to take 2 of it. Now if I was to write NO3 and I need it twice, so I put a 2 in there, it really looks as if we've got 1 N and 32 oxygens, so all these oxygens, which is clearly not what we've got. We want to indicate that we've got 2 nitrates, and the way we do this is anytime we multiply a compound ion by 2 or 3, we must always put it in round brackets and then put the number outside the brackets at the bottom right. And this is the way it's done. It must be done exactly like this. And I did say that for simple ions like the copper ion, if you're ever multiplying those by 2 or 3, you must not use brackets. We'll see this illustrated again, but compound ions, if we take one of a compound ion, we must not put it in brackets. So if we had something like, this is a proper formula, NaNO3, we have one of this sodium ion, which is a simple ion, and we have one of the nitrate ion, which is a compound ion, we're only taking one of that and we must not put that in brackets. So for example, I would not want to see this written. This would be wrong. No need for the brackets, and the brackets must not go in. Okay, let's work out the RMM of copper nitrate, CuNO3, twice. Just listen to how we pronounce that with pauses. Sorry, that should say twice there, of course. CuNO3 twice. CuNO3 twice. Now, so what do we have here? In this formula here, we've got 1 copper. Now, in the brackets NO3, we've got NOOO. That's what NO3 means. The 3 means 3 O's, but there's only 1 N. But the brackets indicates that we've got 2 of what's in the brackets. We've got a 2 outside, so we've 2 of these NO3s. So what have we got in total in copper nitrate? We've got 1 copper, which can be rounded up as being 1 copper is rounded up as being 64. In GCN, in A level, you would take it more accurately, so I think it's 63.5. We've got 2 nitrogens. Each nitrogen is 14, so that gives us 28 overall for nitrogen. And then we've 6 oxygens. Each oxygen is 16, so that would be 96 overall. And so we've got 188 of my masses right there. Again, pause for a moment to establish what we've learnt. We've learnt how to use brackets when we have to multiply a compound ion by 2 or 3. We've learnt how to reason what is present in terms of atoms in a complex formula of this type. Okay, let's try another one. So aluminium, that's a simple ion. We'll find that in the periodic table. Hydroxide we came across a few moments ago. That's a compound ion, so you'll be looking for that on the data sheet. Can you find aluminium? It's a metal, so it's going to be under the staircase, which comes along here. Yep, there's aluminium. It's in group 3. It's a metal, so it's going to be positive if it's a metal. If it's in group 3, it's going to be 3 positive. So it's written as Al with a 3 plus charge. What about hydroxide? Hydroxide is a compound ion. What's its formula? OH. What's its charge? Minus. So we have Al with a 3 plus charge, and we have OH with a minus charge. So we have a 3 plus ion, and we have a minus ion. How will we balance this? Well, we need another two of these to balance it. So we're taking times 1 that, and times 3 this. Again, stick with it so that you put the numbers in the correct place. We have 1 aluminium, and as far as the hydroxide ion is concerned, we need 3 of those. But we can't simply do that, because that would multiply the H by 3 and not the oxygen. Remember that when it comes to this, we must, anytime we multiply compound ion by 2 or 3, we must put it in round brackets and put the number outside. That way it multiplies all parts of the compound ion by that number. What does aluminium hydroxide indicate? Well, it indicates we've got 1 aluminium. The OH means we have that, but then we have 3 of those. So this is what we have in total in aluminium hydroxide. So as we now begin to work out the relative molecular mass, so we've got 1 aluminium. If you look that up in the periodic table, aluminium has the numbers 13 and 27. And it's this number we're looking for. Its atomic mass is 27, so it contributes 27 to the overall mass. How many oxygens do we have? Up here you can see we have 3 oxygens, each having an atomic mass of 16. So we get a total of 48 from the oxygens. How many hydrogens do we have? We have 3 hydrogens, each contributing 1. So that's 3. So the mass, the relative molecular mass, comes out to be 78. Let's try another one. Hopefully you're getting used to these by now. Here we have a metal silver and a non-metal bromine, forming the bromide ion. Silver bromide. Silver. What's the charge of the silver ion? Again, you will not find the silver ion here. The silver ion will be indicated. I have been remiss here not putting it in on the data sheet. The silver ion would be given. It would write, should be written as silver 1. Silver only ever forms a 1 plus ion, and its formula then is Ag plus. So that's the silver part of this question. And then bromide. Can you find what the bromide ion would be? Where's bromine found? It's in group 7. It's a non-metal. It's going to be minus. In group 7, it has 7 electrons in its outer shell. We're supposed to reason then that it has a single minus charge. Sorry. back to silver bromide now. So the silver ion is Ag with a positive charge, and the bromide ion, Br, with a single minus charge. So we have a positive ion and we have a negative ion, and this time we just need one of each. So the formula is AgBr2. Things are beginning to play up here, hopefully you can see that. So we would have 1 times silver and 1 times Br. Silver is 108, I believe, could be wrong on that, and bromine is 80. Not sure about that, so I'm not going to complete that. Check out what silver is and then simply add the two together. Here's another example, calcium nitride. What does iodide alert us to? That should alert us to the fact that iodide is the element on its own. So we have nitrogen on its own here. This is not nitrate or nitrite for that matter. Iodide indicates we have nitrogen on its own. So we're going to look for calcium and nitrogen, the ions that they would form using the periodic table. Can you find calcium? It's in group 2. It's a metal, so it's definitely going to be positive. It's in group 2, so it's 2 positive. What about nitrogen? Can you find nitrogen and subsequently the nitride ion? Here's nitrogen, it's in group 5. Being in group 5, it will have 5 electrons in its outer shell. Will it lose 5? Will it gain 3? It will gain 3. If it gains 3 electrons, it'll end up with 3 more electrons than it has protons. Electrons are negative, so it'll end up with a net charge of 3 minus. That's the formula of the nitride ion. So we have Ca 2 plus and we have N 3 minus. So we have a 2 plus ion and we have a 3 minus ion. How can we balance this? Now we can't slip in a little plus here to make it sorted out, because we don't have a positive ion, we only have a 2 positive ion and a 2 minus ion, so we can't do that. What will we do? Well, what are we lacking? Are we lacking positive or negative charge? We're lacking positive charge, so we've no choice but to take another 2 plus to see if that sorts it out. Does it? No. Now we've got too much positive charge. We've no choice then but to take another 3 minus. Does that sort it out? I'm afraid not. We've now 6 minus and 4 plus, so we just have to keep going, toggling back and forth until we get it. Let's take another positive charge. Is that sorted out? Well, we've got 3 2 plus ions, which gives us an overall charge of 6 plus. And we have 2 3 minus ions, which gives us an overall charge of 6 minus. So yeah, that sorts it. Again, stick with it here so that you put the numbers in the right place. How many calciums did we take? Yeah, we took 3 of those. And how many nitride ions did we take? Yeah, we took 2 of those. And that's the formula, Ca3N2. So we've got 3 calciums. Calcium is 40. So that's 3 40s, 120. We have 2 nitrogens. Nitrogen's 14, so that's 28. So we have 148. That's the relative molecular mass of calcium nitride. Ammonium sulfate next. Is this an element? Is this an element? Ammonium sulfate. Neither of these are elements, these are compound ions. Can you see here in red what you would find on the periodic table? Can you see the ammonium ion somewhere? And the sulfate ion somewhere? What's the formula of the ammonium ion? NH4. And separately, what's the charge of the ammonium ion? Written in black here. Yeah, positive. What does NH4 mean? Well, it means we've got one nitrogen, and the 4 means we have 4 hydrogens. Now, can you see the sulfate ion somewhere? Yep. And what is the formula of the sulfate ion? SO4. And separately, what's the charge of a sulfate ion, written in black here? Yep, 2-. And what does SO4 mean? It means you've got one sulfur, and the 4 indicates 4 oxygens. So let's go back and work this one out. The ammonium ion is NH4, with a positive charge. The sulfate ion is SO4, with a 2- charge. So we have a positive ion, and we have a 2- ion. How can we balance this? Yeah, we need another of these. So we need 2 ammonium ions. So again, stick with this, make sure you get the numbers in the right place. So we have the ammonium ion, which is a compound ion. Did we take more than one? Yes, we did. We took 2 of these. Now, how will we sort this out, given that it's a compound ion? We must use round brackets. We put the 2 down here. How many of these sulfate ions did we take? Just 1. SO4. Do we need to put that in brackets, given that it's a compound ion? No, we must not put it in brackets, because although it's a compound ion, we've only taken 1 of this. So let's work out the RMN of ammonium sulfate. Now, what does this bit of the formula indicate? Well, NH4 is N, H, 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 and H, 4 H's. But the 2 indicates we have 2 of those, so we have another one of those. And what does this indicate, SO4? Well, it indicates we've got an S, and the 4 means we've got 4 O's. There's quite a lot in this formula, as you can see. How many nitrogens are there? 2. And each is 14. Atomic mass, relative atomic mass of 14, so 2 14s, 28. How many hydrogens have we got in this? 8 hydrogens. Each contributing 1, so that's 8 altogether. How many sulfurs have we got? We've got 1 sulfur, contributing 32. And how many oxygens do we have here? We've got 4 oxygens. Put this back to front, I know, but as long as we've got it the right way. So we have 4 oxygens, and each is 16, so it gives us a total of 64. If we add all of that up, 6, 14, 22, 132. So the relative molecular mass of ammonium sulfate is at 132, if I've done my maths correctly. I'll do just a few more examples here. Hydrochloric acid. Let's see if you can do this along with me. Now, hydrochloric acid, like all acids, it has a second name beginning with hydrogen. Hydrochloric acid could also be called hydrogen chloride. It's helpful to know that, because then we know what ions make hydrogen chloride up, or make hydrochloric acid up. Hydrochloric acid can be called hydrogen chloride. You can hear it in the name, I think. Hydrochloric, hydrogen chloride. What's sulfuric acid called then? Sulfuric hydrogen sulfate, made up of hydrogen ions and sulfate ions. What's nitric acid made up of? What's the other name for nitric acid? Nitric hydrogen nitrate. Okay, so hydrochloric acid is made up of hydrogen ions. If we look where hydrogen is, remember hydrogen's in group 1, and it'll form a 1 plus ion. And chloride, chlorine here, is in group 7, and it forms the Cl minus ion. So we're made up of the H plus and the Cl minus. We have a positive ion, and we have a negative ion. So we only need one of each of these, and the formula then of hydrochloric acid, otherwise known as hydrogen chloride, is simply HCl. In terms of its RMM, we have 1 hydrogen, relative atomic mass 1, and we have 1 chlorine, relative atomic mass 35.5, which gives us a total of 36.5 as a relative molecular mass, or formula mass, of hydrochloric acid. If we were dealing with sulfuric acid, sulfuric acid, it's helpful to know that sulfuric acid could be called hydrogen sulfate, and it's made up of hydrogen ions and sulfate ions. How would we balance that? We'd need to take this times 2. The formula is H2SO4. What about nitric acid? What's the other name for nitric acid? Hydrogen nitrate, yeah. So it's made up of hydrogen ions, H plus, and the nitrate ion, can you remember what the formula of the nitrate ion was? It was NO3. What was its charge? Single minus. So again, we need one of each of these, so the formula is simply HNO3. Now, we'll spend just a few minutes with covalent compounds and covalent elements. You don't get any help in GCSE with these. They won't be present on the data sheet. You won't be able to work them out really from the periodic table either, perhaps. So you need to commit these all to memory. These are all elements that are covalent. Most of them are twos, like hydrogen H2 here, chlorine Cl2, bromine Br2, iodine I2, oxygen O2, nitrogen N2. That's to say that these molecules here, which we refer to as diatomic, di means two, literally, a molecule made up of two atoms bonded together. What's the significance of this? Well, it's important that a formula reflects how the substance exists in nature. And hydrogen doesn't exist as separate atoms. It exists as atoms paired up, and so the formula H2 reflects that. Same is true of chlorine. Chlorine doesn't exist as separate atoms. It exists as pairs of atoms bonded together. Same for bromine, same for iodine, same for oxygen, and the same for nitrogen. Now what about these? These are the noble gases. These are the ones that are happy to stay the way they are. They have a full outer shell. They're not interested in bonding. And they are referred to, as opposed to diatomic, they are referred to as monatomic, which means that they are single atoms. So the formula of a noble gas is the same as its symbol. And when we're on the matter, it's the formula, by the way, of any metal, such as sodium or copper or iron. The same is true. The formula of any metal is the same as its symbol. There's about 60 metals in the periodic table. So if you're asked for the symbol of sodium, it's Na. If you're asked for the formula of sodium, it's also Na. If you're asked for the symbol of copper, it's Cu. If you're asked for the formula for copper, it's Cu. Now these are covalent compounds that we come across in GCSE. Maybe I should deal with these ones in green here, perhaps first. These are covalent. These are elements sulfur and phosphorus. Now the proper formula, the proper way of representing sulfur, a non-metal element, is S8, to reflect the fact that sulfur exists as molecules in which we have got 8 sulfurs joined together. See if I can draw this. If I start with a W and put a sulfur at each of these corners, how many sulfurs is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Put another one in here, another one in here, another one in here. I think we can kind of get something close to what it looks like. It's described as a puckered ring. That's the way sulfur actually exists in nature, S8. But what chemists do, and this is, we all do this, when we deal with sulfur in equations, we cheat and we represent the formula of sulfur in equations as simply S. But do recall that if we wanted to reflect the way sulfur actually exists in nature, we should be writing S8. But you can see how dealing with an 8 would complicate matters. And dealing with it as S is very satisfactory in terms of representing its reactions. The same is true is true of phosphorus. In nature, phosphorus exists as molecules where we have 4 phosphorus atoms joined together. But again, in equations, we simply represent phosphorus as P. So again, we cheat a little bit. Now let's take a look at the compounds here, these covalent compounds. You should stop the Snapcast for a while and just reflect upon these. Write them down, and you need to commit them to memory. So water, H2O, carbon dioxide, di means 2, CO2, carbon monoxide, mon means 1. So So there are plenty of clues in the name. Sulfur dioxide, di means 2, SO2. Sulfur trioxide, tri means 3, SO3. Ammonia, remember we came across the ammonium ion, which was NH4+. You must listen to the end of that word. Is it ammonia, the person's saying, or is it ammonium? If they're saying ammonia, it's the gas. And you cannot say ammonium, full stop. Something should follow it. It could be ammonium chloride, ammonium nitrate. It doesn't go on its own, unless the person states specifically, we're talking about the ammonium ion. You can say ammonia. You can't say ammonium, you have to say ammonium something. So listen for the clues. Hydrogen peroxide. Peroxide. Formula is H2O2. A peroxide is where we get this unusual thing happening here. We get two oxygens bonded together, like this. In case of hydrogen peroxide, the hydrogen on either side, H2O2. Its structure is not examined in GCSE. Nitrogen monoxide, you're getting the clue again, mon means 1. Nitrogen dioxide means 2. Okay. And let's finish off quickly then by just looking at the RMMs of a few of these covalent substances. So ammonia, hopefully you remember, is NH3. So we've got one nitrogen, which is 14. And NH3 means NHHH, three hydrogens. So we have three hydrogens present, each contributing one. So the RMM of ammonia is 17. Sulfur dioxide, sulfur di means 2, SO2. So we have one sulfur, contributes 32 to the atomic mass, the relative molecular mass. SO2 means SOO. So we have two oxygens, each contributing 16. Coincidentally gives us another 32, so we have a total of 64. Sulfur trioxide, tri means 3, SO3. So we have one sulfur, gives us 32. We have three oxygens this time. SO3 means SOOO. So we have three oxygens, three 16s this time, 48. Gives us a total of 80. That's the RMM of sulfur trioxide. Sulfur. Well, that depends what we're dealing with here, but as I've said, we usually cheat and simply assume that sulfur is S. And the person cannot leave you in any doubt as to what they're talking about, or the question would be unfair unless it made it clear. So if it says sulfur, my advice is to assume that it's S. But if it's spelling out that it's sulfur as it exists in nature, it should be S8. And therefore you should be taking 8 times S. Which is 832s. But can I emphasize that unless it's made blatantly clear to you that we're dealing with this, always assume it's just simply S. Hydrogen peroxide, remember that one I showed a moment ago? Two oxygens bonded like this, and then we've got the H. Its formula is H2O2. So what about its RMM? We're going to have two H's, each contributing 1. We're going to have two oxygens, each contributing 16. So we've got 34 there. Sulfuric acid, do you remember that I said it has an alternative name, like all acids? The thing common to acids is that they all have hydrogen ions. What's the alternative name for sulfuric acid that we can hear in its name? Sulfuric, hydrogen. It's got hydrogen ions, hydrogen. What's the other ion? A compound ion, hydrogen sulfate, yep. Which has, if you look it up in your data sheet, its formula is SO4 and its charge is 2-. So we have a plus, we have a 2-. What do? We take another plus. So the formula then is H2SO4. So we have two hydrogens, which contributes 2. SO4 means we've got SOOOO, so we have one sulfur. Contributes 32, and we have four oxygens, which contributes 4, 16, 64. That comes out as 98. The relative molecular mass of sulfuric acid. And the final question, nitric acid. What was the alternative name for nitric acid? All acids have an alternative name that begins with hydrogen. They all have hydrogen ions in them. What's the other ion present in nitric acid? Which one of those compound ions? Nitric acid, hydrogen, nitrate. And the formula, the nitrate ion, NO3. And the charge of the nitrate ion, single minus. So we have a positive ion and we have a negative ion. And of course that's balanced, so the formula reflects that we take one of each. HNO3. So in terms of the RMM, we have one hydrogen, which contributes 1. We have one nitrogen, which contributes 14. And HNO3 is literally HNOOO. So we have 3 oxygens, which contribute 16 each, giving us a total of 48. So, between 1, we have a relative molecular mass of 63. And that completes this rather lengthy snapcast on determining the formula of a compound, or in the case of covalent compounds, memorizing the formula, and secondly, working out the relative molecular mass or formula mass on the basis that is the sum of its parts. I hope that you find that useful. Thank you for listening.